Have you ever heard of a wonderswan color? Huh? Not that kind of swan. I'm talking about this handheld gaming device that never made it out of Asia. You have not? Don't worry, me neither. And here it is, our beautiful handheld with literally a dozen buttons. The reason for the odd button placement is the versatility of this device. You can play the handheld in portrait mode. How cool is that?
Wow!
If you look at the price tag, you will see that it's priced in Japanese yen. Why? Because my buddy Rob snagged this gem straight from the tech mecca of Akihabara in Japan. Talk about a souvenir, right? It cost him 4,000 yen, what is about $27. Let's check out what's wrong with it and try to get it fixed, shall we? What is impressive is that a single AA battery powers the device. Rob also brought me two games. The game shown here was designed for the predecessor, the Wonderswan. That is why it is a grayscale game with no colors. The second game was designed for the Wonderswan color, as you can read on the packaging. Let's open the grayscale game first to check if the console works. Don't worry, the Wonderswan color is backward compatible with those games. By the way, this game costs 880 yen, which is about $6. The second game, the color one, is much more expensive. Let's put in some batteries, let's put a single AA battery in this thing. First we will check if the battery is full. We should see something around 1.5 volt. Nice. Time to insert the battery and slide the tray into it. With the help of this little slider, we can lock the battery tray in place. The power button is a bit picky. We should see a brief screen flashing when pushing it. This seems to be a normal behavior because we have not inserted any game yet. Let's change that and see what comes with a Wonderswan game cartridge. We start with the mentioned grayscale game. This is the game's manual, which is nicely made and colored. I'm not sure why we sometimes read English terms in it, and the rest is in Japanese, I guess. I have absolutely no idea what this little sheet is about. It seems to mention the game itself, or is it just a warranty card? If anyone knows what it is, please let me know in the comments. Now to the fun part, the game itself. It is nicely protected in this little tray. Let's insert it to try it out. Just to be safe, let's clean the game contacts with a cotton swab and 99% isopropyl alcohol, also known as IPA. A light wipe of the contacts is all that is needed for cleaning. We insert a freshly cleaned cartridge to see what we are dealing with. Awesome! We have picture and sound, and yes, you read that right! The console manufacturer is Bandai. This small wheel on the left is for the screen contrast. Unfortunately, this will not fix the dead pixel in the center of our screen. The game seems to be some rhythm game, at least I think so. But okay, this is how it looks with an older game. How about the color game? We have a problem with the power button. The device should power off when pressing it, but it's not. Let's make a bad move. Remove the cartridge while it's still powered on. Okay, nothing explodes.
Yes, otherwise it explodes.
Ooh, fancy mosaic. Okay, we can only power it off by pulling the battery tray. Now to the color game. Unwrap it. Open the box. Weird English-Japanese mix. The mystery sheet thingy. And the game itself. Fast cleaning the contacts. And throwing it in the slot. Let's press the power button. We are greeted with a colored splash screen. Nice. Nevertheless, I'm pretty sure that the dead pixels in the center of the screen are unfixable. Instead of replacing the damaged screen with the original one, we will try to upgrade it with an IPS screen. That's why I ordered this IPS kit on AliExpress for about $60. Let's see what comes with it. I prefer my iFixit screwdrivers, but they included this little Torx tool to open it. Nice move. The kit is from a brand called High Speedido. In the back, we got all we need to mod, or in our case, to repair this beauty. A ribbon cable for the connection of the IPS screen to the motherboard, the screen itself and the controller board. What you see here is the touch control for the brightness and different screen modes. This is a new adhesive sticker for fixing the screen into place. It also comes with two red wires for ground and power. A shiny new screen plate is also a welcome addition. Let's start a timer to see how long it takes to get this job done. To open it up, we grab a Torx bit. We remove all visible screws from the back. But in the meantime, I would like to know if you have ever heard of this console. I had no idea it existed. Write it in the comments, I'm very curious. The last screw is out, let's remove the battery tray. Afterwards, we can open the shell. What could be the meaning of this mysterious written 3?
We'll never know.
I know, Scully, and I can prove it.
With the help of a sputter, we unlock the screen's ribbon cable and remove it. The motherboard is now free of the chains and can be lifted. These four contacts are the power button. It looks like they plan to use a tactile button instead of a membrane. Let's remove the four dampers. They are glued in place. I think the easiest way to remove them is to use hot air. I use the low settings, 100 degrees C. Maybe we can try it without hot air and use some IPA. Let's try it. We can wet the dampers with a soaked cotton swab. Unfortunately, this won't help at all. Back to the hot air method. Nice, all dampers are removed. Let's clean the button membrane with some IPA. Hopefully this helps a bit with our power button issue. We will also clean all visible contacts with IPA and remove the remains of the damper glue. The speaker appears to be a bit rusty. Yummy. The black stuff around the speaker is completely brittle. We will remove the rest of the button membranes and give them a good clean. For the next step, we will need our soldering iron and the cables provided in the kit. Let's position the fume extractor. We don't want to get those nasty fumes in our lungs. Time to grab our trusty microscope camera for a better view. By the way, we need to solder the thin wires to the battery terminals. We will start with the ground wire. For soldering, we will use flux for better solder flow. Put some solder on the joint and solder the wire in place. One side is done, let's do the same with the power wire. We will remove the remains of the flux with IPA and a cotton swab. Nice. The ground wire must be routed through this hole. Time to take the controller board out of the kit. Now we need to solder the wires to this board. The kit also includes two stickers to isolate the screen from the board to prevent short circuits. We place one of them on the main board of the wonderswan color. The previously mentioned ribbon cable is the next one, and we plug it into the controller board with the blue side facing up. It is time to pry the old screen out of the case using a spatula. When the adhesive is too strong, it is always a good idea to use some heat to soften it. we use the same settings as previously. Here it is, our faulty screen. Let us get rid of the price tag. Now we will remove the old screen plate. We will use the new one that comes with the kit. You guessed it, we use the lowest setting on our hot air station, 100 degrees C. To remove it, we apply gentle pressure from the back of the plate. I was surprised to find that the new plate felt much heavier than the original. Before applying the new plate, we clean the remains of the old plate with 99% IPA. Let's remove the foil. As you can see, the middle part is still on. We need to remove it. Nice. We carefully install the new screen plate. Before we apply the second isolation sticker, let's clean the fingerprints of our shiny new IPS screen. We connect the new screen to the controller board. Before installing the screen, let's blow some compressed air into the case to remove any dust. We will use the old adhesive. It is still sticky enough. But what is not so easy is to align the screen properly. The controller board can now be placed on top of the screen. To fix it in place, we use some captain tape. We put a few strips of tape around the board. Let's insert the button membranes and give them a short blast with compressed air. The two wires with the copper tape at the end are the touch controls. One for brightness and the other for the color modes. To install them, we have to peel off the flimsy film and place them inside the case so that we can reach them with our fingers later. Time to re-insert the motherboard, taking care not to pinch any cables. The ribbon cable from the controller board to the motherboard must be folded to fit inside the case. Now the backplate. Let's put the screws back in. It won't fit. Oh, I see the problem. Can you see it too? We need to reopen it. We have the power button membrane facing the wrong way. Let's fix that. Okay, and second try. Let's put the battery in. I still can't believe it works with only one battery. Afterward, we insert the game. Let's start to fire it up. Wow, this looks brilliant, and we have a backlight. How cool is that? Using one of the touch controls, we should be able to cycle through a number of different color palettes. But this only makes sense for the grayscale games. How about the brightness levels? Let's try the other touch control. Okay, it seems like it's hard to do with the same finger, because we are also going to touch the other control. But as you can see, the brightness can be adjusted as well. Look, the new IPS screen on the right is much more vibrant. It is like day and night. By the way, this is what it looks like when you play something in portrait mode. Very cool. The grayscale rhythm game also looks much better now. We can adjust the color mode to our liking, which is great. The only thing that drives me crazy is the fact that the power button doesn't turn off the device. I think I have to revisit this fault. If anyone has a solution for this, please let me know in the comments. Have a heart for broken devices, and until next time, bye! Under an hour. Nice.